I don't know what a best director is, except that someone that stands in the same space with the best actors. I feel that they do the work, and I get to watch. And nothing's better than that.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Let's Take Five, the podcast where we pick a cinema legend, take five of their films to highlight their excellence and range. My name is Austin Luger.
My name's Eric Martindale.
And today is the beginning of our Robert Altman Five. Coming up, we're going to be covering McCabe, Mrs. Miller, Nashville, Shortcuts, and A Prairie Home Companion. But today, we are starting with perhaps his biggest breakout film, MASH. And for the first time on the podcast, we have a guest on the very first episode of
the
Five.
Is this the first time?
It is, yeah. So we are happy to have an old work friend of mine, Nick Hussong. Nick, welcome.
Hi, guys. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Now, Nick, I wanted you on here because, first off, you are a fantastic history buff, and I would love to hear your thoughts on kind of the look at Vietnam at this time, but also, this is your favorite film, right?
Yeah, it is definitely my favorite comedy. I think that it is the best comedy that has ever been made. Maybe some other competitors, but I think MASH beats them all out barely.
For anyone out there who has never seen MASH, or perhaps only seen the TV show, you'll recognize a lot of the names. This is the story of Hawkeye Pierce, who arrives in Korea. He steals a Jeep right away and goes to the MASH 4077, where he is there with a variety of other interesting people, including Duke Forrest, arrives on the same day, Major Margaret Hot Lips Houlihan, Frank Burns, Colonel Henry Blake, Father John McCahey, Radar O'Reilly, and later on, Trapper John arrives as well. And they kind of deal with being doctored not too far from the front line and keeping their sanity. Unlike the TV show, this definitely is significantly edgier in terms of its characterization, humor, and also just depiction of war. This movie, to me, I love the show. I've never read the book series, but this is it depicts chaos and humor as a defense mechanism in a way that I've never like seen before. Nick, why does this movie connect with you so much?
Well, I think that it is the darkest of dark comedies. I mean, if you look at the, you know, they make a sight gag out of Hawkeye having a nurse use a tool to scratch his nose while he's amputating someone's leg. And I think when I was a kid, I would watch the TV show reruns with my mom on a pretty routine basis, and she actually showed me the movie when I was pretty young. I was probably 10 or 11. It was on TV, so a lot of the things that an 11-year-old probably shouldn't see weren't in there, and I hated it because I was used to the TV show characters, and my young mind could not wrap itself around the fact that these are the same characters being played by different people. And then I saw it later as a teenager when I was going through my rebellious small town phase, and I think I just identified quite a bit with the level to which these characters get away with bucking authority and going about getting what they want. And it's hilarious. I don't think that I'd ever seen a movie like that before, and I think that in terms of Robert Altman's sort of layered dialogue going on in the same movie, I think this is probably his best effort.
You know, there's something very interesting you said there right at the very beginning, which I felt as well quite a bit seeing this film, and in reference to it being a dark comedy, but also dark comedy is exactly what it is, but also the way it lays its groundwork of cynicism and the way these characters seem to go in and out of phases where they're either drinking or drunk and making gags to trying to save soldiers' lives. And some of the hospital scenes, you know, it gives the impression that these people are funny, they're cut-ups, but then it keeps constantly reminding you that, oh yeah, they're, you know, 3 miles from the front line, and they're also really good doctors and they're saving people's lives, which that the way it strikes the balance of that, I think, grounded the comedy in a way where I don't think a lot of other comedies necessarily ever go to, because either one, they don't have to put in the effort, they're going to get their cheap laughs anyway. Actually, no, that would probably be the biggest one. So if you're able to tell a story and ground it in a relatable way, where the characters don't come off as cartoons, and they come off as doctors who got drafted and don't want to be there, I think that it's relatable in a way. I think it really, really, really works. And it's the best football movie ever made.
that may very well be true, but that actually sort of ties into the genesis for the book. Is that, if I remember, the author of the book was a military surgeon and made a comedy out of a situation that very, very much was not, that there were these mobile army surgical hospitals very close to the front lines. And being the military, it's sort of their edict that you put your best trained people in the worst situations and expect good results. So it was, that's why these doctors are by and large Ivy League educated, surgeons who were brought there, and in reality it almost certainly was not anywhere close to as funny as this, but they had an extremely high survival rate, especially considering the wounds that they were seeing. And they make reference in the movie to working 14-hour days, and that was very realistic, that they could be working 14, 16, 18-hour days, and that they very much were drunk basically any time that they weren't in the operating room. So it's good that someone found comedy in that. I don't know that the people who actually did it managed to find a lot.
And it's so interesting when they are in their off hours, because that's when you get to see so many of their opinions of, you know, the anti-authority towards the military structure, a lot of Frank Burns and Hot Lips' hypocrisy. But I also really enjoyed seeing in the movie how the characters never complained when their shift was coming up. Like, this is what they have to do. This is what they are here for. Like, no one's like pressing snooze on the alarm kind of thing, or no one's trying to finish a poker hand when the siren calls. That to me was always so impressive, because, you know, in many ways they are these hero figures who are doing this incredible work so far on the front line. On the other hand, they are really darker characters who mentally handle what they're doing by kind of stripping away societal norms.
Well, their backs are against the wall. They're not going anywhere.
Yeah.
So, and, you know, at some point along the way, they got the education they did because they wanted to be surgeons and doctors or whatever. They just didn't want to be in the war. So from that perspective, and the most poignant moment for me, I think the moment that sort of elevated the movie for me, and it's a bit on the nose, but I think it fit and worked really well, is when Hot Lips is giving shit to Hawkeye about how, you probably already know where I'm going with this, but she's giving shit to Hawkeye about, you know, what do you think of Frank Burns? And then she's like, I don't know how someone that awful got to this position in this great military. And then someone said he was drafted. I love that so much.
One of the best edits ever. Like, it is out of there.
Yeah, it's like, it was almost as if there's one thing we want you to hear from this movie, it's this line.
Yeah.
And I think it's great. I think it's fantastic. And then from that moment on, I mean, there are times where I shift away from being on their sides because their prank's borderline on criminal, but
I think borderline.
Not
borderline. Not borderline. They're sociopaths.
Exactly. Yeah. But from that moment, oddly, I felt like that was sort of enough to always sort of put me on Hawkeye's side. I mean, he didn't ask for any of this. And there's something really relatable to that. I don't know.
Well, I mean, it's his first action, right? It's can I take this car? No, this is the army. You wait for you're a side driver. I can do it inside.
Yeah, fuck you. I don't want to be here anyway. Yeah, I know. It's interesting.
Something that I really took away from rewatching it last night was because, you know, you get some funny jokes with the radio announcer having to read the dumb little things and the dumb movies they're playing that are kind of great war propaganda films.
So they're obviously war propaganda, too.
But then, like, it ends with him saying, you know, tonight's feature is MASH, starring Donald Sutherland and yada. I loved that not only as a fun way to close up the film, but also to say, by the way, all those soldiers that were in those happy, cheery Henry Fonda war films that you saw also lived like this. Mm-hmm. Like, we'll gloss it up later, but this is also the kind of, like, this is what they did. This is who they were. All your heroes were this uncomfortable as well.
And not just uncomfortable, but I think that one of the things that sets this movie apart from the war movies that came before it is the constant theme of the incompetence of the army bureaucracy,
yeah,
and how easily manipulated it is. I think that was the big thing that that made the military ban this movie from being shown on military bases, is that that's probably something that all soldiers would identify with, is sort of the unfeeling nonsense and incompetence of the military bureaucracy.
You know, in the show, one of the, you know, examples of that is a bit of the Frank Burns character. You know, he's very nice, but he's very dumb about that. In this, it's a different kind. Not Frank Burns. Colonel Blake. I want to talk about Colonel Blake for a second, because that actor is so funny in this as Blake. And I love that, like, I mean, Radar basically runs the entire camp. Radar knows what everything's doing. But I do love that the actor playing Blake frequently tells you that he is listening. Because the whole, like, Hawkeye, do you steal this car? No, it's outside there. Okay, good, yada, yada. And then, like, he rambles 15 more things, and Radar's saying that. But then he ends with, oh, and change those plates on that truck. I feel to me like Blake knows the game more than a lot of other people involved. Like, he knows that he can get Frank Burns out of their tent, but it's actually hard to get finances to get an actual good cutter.
You know, it's great. And he's what's great is he's sort of the spearheader of, like, this whole rejection of authority type of thing. I mean, getting to that bureaucracy of the military and whatnot, I think that's sort of what, I keep going back to this word, I think I've said it more than any other word or any podcast we've done, is relatable, because mm-hmm. I think a big way of going to ground these characters, because, you know, I've never served in a MASH unit, but I can certainly sympathize with, in his case, in Blake's case, being middle management, and then having people below me that know that this whole thing we're working for, this whole cause, is just bullshit, and I'm just here for this whatever reason. But I don't know. It's really interesting, and I think it's really highlighted not just from the great script, because the script's incredible too, and the characterization's fantastic, but the acting in this movie is awesome. Like, this is my favorite Donald Sutherland performance. Like, a mile. He's so awesome in this as Hawkeye. But everyone else, even when their characters are very, very, like, character-y, like Radar or something like that, they're always consistent, and the joke is always consistent, and it just really works.
Because Radar, I mean, he's the one actor who's on the show.
See, that's what I thought. Yeah, and I was thinking about that watching this. I was like, I think he's on the show. I mean, I'm kind of like you, Nick. I watched it with my dad a lot when I was little, and I remember Radar as a kid. Radar's humor was very funny to me, and I just liked the way that he looked. He was small, he made funny, quirky jokes that I could get as a little child, but I was pretty certain that was the same actor.
But in the show, he's so sweet. He has the grape knee high. You know, he's the very sweet, like, child role in the sitcom family. In this, I love, because, like, I'm so used to seeing that face in relation to that role. Like, when he's outside that tent and, like, he has the big wide eyes, like, because he's catching Frank Burns and Hot Lips having sex, you're thinking, like, oh, man, he's so naive, he hasn't seen sex before. Then he realizes he's holding the mic, and then he brings that up.
Yeah, one of the great pan-downs in cinema history.
Yeah. And it's so, I mean, the performances, I mean, this is where you get to see the Altman style of, you know, the overlapping dialogue and sometimes maybe not even facing the microphone. Like, it's just so naturalistic. And Donald Sutherland and Elliot Gould are just so perfect at it.
Oh, God, they rule it. I was going to say, Nick, I don't know, I assume you've seen McCabe and Mrs. Miller, too. And then this is kind of like, for me, what I find so, like, spectacular about Altman is this idea of setting, like, making the areas in which these characters inhabit actually feeling like living, breathing places that they inhabit. They're not necessarily the stars of it. They are, of course, because we're following their progression through the movie, but the MASH unit, very much like Presbyterian Church and McCabe and Mrs. Miller, exist as, like, a living, breathing entity where you have a huge cast, a huge variety of characters that even if you don't remember their names necessarily, you know what the roles they fill are, and they're constantly shots with all the characters filling up the screen and just existing with their dialogue overlapping in this really sort of interesting, as you said, naturalist way, which is something that Altman definitely, I think perfects later with McCabe and Mrs. Miller, but I think it works to great effect here, too. I don't know if you agree with that, Nick, or...
Yeah, and I think it's interesting that in both cases the main actors involved tried to get Altman fired because they did not understand what he was doing. I mean, and it makes sense. Like, if you are sort of film veterans, which obviously Donald Sutherland was, and then Warren Beatty was, on McCabe and Mrs. Miller, you would think it was just chaos. You would not have any understanding how what you were seeing being shot would ever become a movie. It would just not make any sense compared to your previous experiences until you started seeing dailies and things like that. But I agree that he really does make it a living space. Just in terms of the number of times where things happening in the background sort of begin to interplay with what you're seeing in the foreground. I'm thinking of when Hawkeye starts singing that religious song to make fun of Frank Burns while they're in their tent, and then all the people walking by sort of start singing along and then marching as they're singing that song, or just the whole lead up to where they probably commit a felony exposing Hot Lips Houlihan while she's in the shower. Just sort of the meandering shot of all the different things they do to distract the other nurses so that Hot Lips is the only one in the shower.
It's exactly what I'm talking about, and I think a lot of that comes too from he's sets up a scene sometimes without the featured players existing in it to start the scene. I know that happens a little bit. It happens a little bit in McCabe and Mrs. Miller, but it seems to happen here too. Like, we'll start singing the song, then we'll follow the people that are now marching and singing the song, and maybe that was the purpose of the scene all along. In particular, I think of Presbyterian Church. Well, this isn't Presbyterian. Yeah, it is. Whenever McCabe rides into town at the very beginning with the Leonard Cohen playing, we'll get to that later. But this bar, this whole thing feels like you see it. It exists as a living thing before, way before Mr. McCabe even shows up. And then even once he shows up, you see the little nuggets of which it affects it, kind of like the way the scenes work here. This is where they live. You know, this is where they stay. You know, this is that guy who pours the drinks. This is this guy that does this. This is that girl that does that. And every time you see one of these scenes, you kind of watch them just live in it. And I know that from the perspective of these films, I can see where both Donald Sutherland and, yeah, like you said, Warren Beatty looking at this saying, this is absolutely insane. Like, what is this? It just feels meandering, and you would think it would be boring, but it's actually really exciting.
It's so interesting when Altman is then able to reverse that kind of mindset, because one of my favorite just, like, two-second moments in the movie is when Hawkeye is in town and that woman is a journalist doing kind of a piece for Send the Videos Back Home. And him saying hi to his dad, I mean, you still have the large Altman canvas of, like, there's like 30 extras in the shot right there, but he's the one standing, and he's the one being more sincere in those 2 seconds than he has been the whole movie. It's really sweet. And then it gets interesting to see how Altman then changes his camera a little bit more to, I mean, the shot during the wonderful suicide dinner where he replicates the Last Supper is kind of a mixture of, like, oh, anything goes style to I'm purposely making these exact positions.
Mm-hmm.
It's wonderful. And then the football act is a lot more focused on, like, people have to kind of go here.
The football act's insane.
It is, and there's one thing that
they show every play of that football game. it's crazy.
Really get the whole score. But the one thing that, like, I know this doesn't fully make sense on a character arc all the way through. I even try to, like, bend my back to make it make sense, but it doesn't matter because Hot Lips Houlihan is so funny during those scenes. Like, I don't think, like, her character would be, like, this stupid, this, like, openly, like, guessing what's going on, but her behind Blake's shoulder, like, almost crying every scene is so funny to me. Like, she's stole the whole last half hour.
You know, it's interesting because, like, watching what, like, what of all the films that we've covered, and this is going to sound probably totally out of left field, so let me explain. This actually movie kind of reminded me of Dazed and Confused a bit, and the reason why is because, like,
it ends on a football field.
Well, it ends on a football field, but no, because of the lack of any real central through line, mm-hmm. the characters exist almost as a series of vignettes. And you watch them grow up and change, sometimes maybe to a less, certainly a lesser extent than Dazed and Confused. But you see the way they affect these scenes in a series of vignettes. Now it's more connected in Dazed and Confused because it's an escalating part of a singular day. But in this movie, the only difference is the characters, the scenes feel a little more episodic. For instance, why is Hot Lips O'Houlihan even hanging out with these people? Why is she even volunteering to be a cheerleader here? They just stripped her clothes off, showed her naked.
I had a theory. It's because it's now upper brass sucking up.
Is that your thing? Well, okay.
That's my
And she started sleeping with Duke.
She started sleeping with Duke, but why start sleeping with Duke, too? Like, and again, I don't need to know the answers to these questions.
Was he
but
in the
I
shower scene?
That's a good question.
Yeah, because he's
yeah, yeah, he's the one. He's the one that won the bet.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, of course. Also, I do enjoy the fact that Duke, who was the second lead for the first half hour, and then was...
And that's exactly what I'm talking about. So yeah. You have Tom Skerritt. By the way, our third Tom Skerritt movie. Because we did Alien,
yep.
We did Contact, and now he pops up here, too.
There goes our top
there goes our five for him. But yeah, but that's kind of what I'm talking about, too. You know, Hawkeye has a different best friend. I mean, in fact, they're like co-leads for the first like 20 minutes or so, and then now we have a new best friend. Yeah. Like after that too, and none of this is a problem for me. Like I'm not upset about any of this, but the fact that we can divide it, show every play of that football game, and say like that is the football act. Like it is kind of like that. This is the shower scene act. This is like everything without that central sort of plot or through line that I have. The movie is pretty much built around characterization.
Well, and so this is not at all a criticism of the film because I really really love this film, but. You know, Nick, you called them sociopaths at the beginning. I, watching this time, I kind of did watch, even within friendly circumstances, I think these characters have no emotional connections to anyone at the camp. Like, whereas MASH, it is, the TV show is, they're all family, they're all in this together, and it makes for a really great sitcom. This, like they kind of leave without saying goodbye at the end. They really, like, their only real motivations is to save as many people as they can. And say fuck you to the people who annoy them. Like that's kind of it. And they hang around those who kind of accomplish those goals well. It's amazing how delightfully unemotional it is because you're in hell. What do you think, Nick?
I think that this film has aged in sort of some very interesting ways, both in terms of watching it now and in sort of the cultural moment that we are in, but also just sort of looking back on it with a different perspective, just having learned some things that I know we talked earlier about them as surgeons and just going about their business and not really complaining about it. I think a lot of that is based on ego, that these guys all know that they are very talented surgeons and they like showing that off, mm-hmm. that they really like, doing the work. From that perspective. And so I know I said earlier that that I really identified with their rebellion against authority in this movie, but it really is sort of a, for them, consequenceless rebellion. One of the things that I think this movie really shows that is maybe not unique to America, but certainly takes place in the United States more than anywhere else, that this really demonstrates meritocracy. These guys know that they are irreplaceable. They know that they can get away with basically whatever they want to do. I mean, there's the scene after they expose Hot Lips in the shower where she goes running to Colonel Blake and just yells at him for letting them get away with everything, and he says essentially that he's just going to let them keep getting away with everything, and they know that. So really, in the end, how much of a rebellion is it when you know that there's no consequences for what you're going to be doing? And then the other part that struck me when I rewatched this is the way that it sort of dances around issues of race, but never really gets directly involved, because you have the moment in the beginning where Donald Sutherland calls the black officer who runs the Jeep pool racist, and then sort of the play around the tragically named spear checker. One of my favorite sort of throwaway jokes in the movie is that completely oblivious nurse asking him, why do they call you spear checker?
Yeah. Well, also you have Tom Skerritt's character of Duke, who we don't know much about his background, but he definitely is a Southern boy.
He doesn't want to be
not thrilled with the idea that a black guy might be sharing a tent with him.
Yeah. Right.
And he made exceptions already for you Yanks.
Yeah.
So this is what he said. But
which I enjoyed.
He has to draw some lines somewhere. It is interesting. They're not rebelling. It's in some ways because they're irreplaceable. This certainly isn't Cool Hand Luke. These guys know they're irreplaceable. They know there are no consequences to their actions in a lot of regards. But the thing I keep coming back to is every time they cross a line, and we talked about, Nick talked about the cultural norms of today. I mean, I don't think people were looking at this, you know. I mean, you watch a National Lampoon movie now, you're going to see, like, it's going to be, oh my God, I can't believe they're peeking at the girls in the shower. But, like, this is, considering the culture of time, the part I keep coming back to that kind of exempts them a little bit from that is they don't want to be there. They never asked for this, you know, which is a big part of why I pardon a lot of their actions, and I'm kind of just kind of cool with it, and I go with the flow. With the exception of the hot lift scene, which crosses a huge line, but it is done in such a, like, staged way, like such a pranky type of mousetrap way that
with
I can't...
Also, the actress responding to it as horror. It isn't like a cheap bad movie where she keeps showering for 5 minutes, not knowing that the curtain's down, you know, kind of thing. Like, she's screaming, it's on the floor.
Yeah.
And when you mentioned the whole going to Blake scene of, like, it's a good thing and everything, she's so good, so convincing, and so, like, upset during that scene, which then, of course, has the great cut to Blake is in bed naked with another woman.
Yeah.
but the thing I thought about race was it's crazy, we have not even mentioned that Robert Duvall is in this film as Frank Burns. And during an early, maybe the first scene with Frank Burns, he's teaching, is his name Ho-Jung?
Can't remember.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. How to read, and the guys find it silly, they just give him a porno. But the way that Frank
Burns... He loves it.
Yeah, huge fan. But Frank Burns, he's so white savior, egotistical asshole, as he's sitting in that tent. And it's like, so then Ho-Jung says, like, can I go for a while? He, like, nod is like a wise Dumbledore, like, yes, you can. Like, he sees himself as way above Ho-Jung.
Would you feel that way if he didn't sleep with Hot Lips? Because I didn't really see him come off as bad guy or necessarily hypocrite until that moment.
I think for me the moment that he becomes a bad guy is where he snaps at Boone when the patient dies. Oh, I don't really care as much that he sleeps with Hot Lips. I think that it's, you know, it's a terrible situation that they're all in. Weird things are going to happen. I don't really mind that hypocrisy, but what really bothers me is him dumping someone's death onto an aide, essentially. I think that was where I turned on Frank.
Yeah, you know what? For whatever reason, I completely forgotten that.
And Elliot Gould's incredible exactly for that scene, because it's the first scene where you really see him give a shit in a that kind of specific way. But Frank Burns, to me, is such a fascinating, awful person, because their first disagreement with him is, you know, they just really are annoyed by his religion, and specifically annoyed by the idea, like, he's making a difference of praying that will help soldiers, as opposed to
praying for the president.
Praying for the president, too, yes. and all the higher-ups, because that prayer goes on for quite a long time. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, consequence-free, Frank Burns ends up in a straitjacket, middle of the film, and does not come back.
No.
And another really good throwaway joke that I really like is, fair's fair, if I nail Hot Lips and punch Hawkeye, can I go home too?
yeah, that's great. I love the just watching Donald Sutherland, like, just make fun of him to his face the whole time. Like, everything just seems so natural. Like, this, it's just funny. It's just really funny stuff. Like, And Donald Sutherland nails all of that, like that rivalry between the two. He's fantastic.
And there's, I mean, there's, he's a great anti-hero in that way. I mean, he, when they have the wonderful suicide sequence, I mean, first off, you get the song Suicide is Painless, which I believe was written by Robert Altman's teenage son. I think I heard that somewhere.
Correct, yeah.
Which is amazing. And I love that it's still the theme song of the TV show, but without the words, so it still has that darkness there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and they refer to it, I believe, in the credits as MASH theme, because they won't even say what the title.
Yeah. And, like, when you see, like, the suicide sequence to me is what makes the movie so brilliant, because no one is going to talk him out of it in that way. No one could say that, hey, it's not that bad, because it actually is that bad. You're feet from the front line.
Mm-hmm.
But we're going to be really kind to you. And one of the ways they're going to be kind to you is to treat what you're saying as true. We're not going to actually let you kill yourself. That's not going to happen. We're just going to give you a really nice night and treat you with respect. And also, you're going to get laid.
Which for me is the sort of the worst exploitation that they do. I sort of agree that with the they don't want to be there, and so all of their hijinks are like sort of sticking a thumb in the eye of the establishment, especially when it's targeting Frank Burns or Hot Lips or the military at large. But Dish doesn't want to be there either. And the sort of the most uncomfortable moment of the movie for me is the look on her face when she's in that helicopter when she's leaving the next day. That just gives me the creeps.
I didn't know what to take of it this time, because like the way that like Hawkeye presents this idea to her, it was still like her choice to do it.
I mean,
he was still actually pushing her of like. Because, I mean, it's life or death kind of thing. But
yeah, but one way you could be looking at it in general, I mean, where she's going home, right?
Yeah.
So she could just be looking back in general on her time spent
here,
rather than specifically that, or she's happy to be going home. It doesn't necessarily have to be.
Or she
it does come, because it's the next time we see her in the movie.
I mean, like, also, I think she had sex in a coffin, which I think is not great for anybody.
Well, we've all been there.
Nope. I think it's time for now. Final thoughts of the movie. Nick, favorite film. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I just the this is I think probably a big part of why I ended up going to film school. This was one of the movies that made me think like, oh, I did not know that movies could be like this, because it really doesn't pay attention to through lines in any sort of traditional way. The same with narrative; it doesn't have a three-act structure. Having all of the overlapping dialogue, I think it is just, it's really different. And I think it took a lot of courage to try to do something like this, and then to succeed on such a massive level, I think it is what makes this film continue to endure and continue to find an audience with people.
I love this movie. It's one that I just... Every time I watch it, I find something new, and the more society changes, the more this is fascinating and still very honest. This is your first time watching it, right, Eric?
Yeah, this was my first time seeing it, so I'd seen the show a lot. This is my first time seeing this movie way too late, obviously. Yeah, no, it's great. There's one other film on this, we'll save until then, the Altman Five that I haven't seen. This was a great movie. I mean, it really, 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 really was. And I really enjoyed... I mean, it's right there with McCabe and Mrs. Miller for me. And that's pretty high praise, because I love McCabe and Mrs. Miller. So,
Which is what we're going to be discussing next Friday. So we hope you all join us then. Until then, you can leave a comment at theartofmoral.com. Let us know what you think about MASH, the movie, the show, the war, everything. Also, while you're there, you can check out the other podcasts on the network. The Immortals yesterday, we covered A Streetcar Named Desire and The Jefferson's. Good stuff there. Ad Absurdum Swears is coming out soon about Westworld. So probably by now, I think it should be up. You can also email us at letstake5@artemore.com. At The Immortals Pod is us on Twitter. The new theme song was once again made by Adam Lord, who now has a website where you can hire him to make your spiffy theme songs. That is songsbyalord.com. Very clever. And Eric, where can we find you?
You can find me at Constant Diversion. That's my YouTube channel. You know that by now. Check me out on there.
Nick, anything to plug?
No, don't find me.
Please do not find Nick.
Don't look for him.
Don't find Nick. But Nick, thank you so much for coming out of the shadows briefly and joining us on this episode, because we greatly appreciate it.
We had to tip the cheese with the mice with mash was the way to pull him out.
Yeah, thanks for having me, guys.
I appreciate it, man.
All right, we'll catch you all next week. I'm Austin Licker.
I'm Eric Martindale.
Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
To the office of the commanding officer.
You meant just passing through?
That is all.
I was just enjoying that lovely dish there.
Captain, you are speaking about a lieutenant in the United States Army. I'm Colonel Blake.
Oh, Colonel. Yeah, I'm Duke Forrest, and you've cut. That's my driver over here.
Captain Hawkeye Pierce. Are you leaving?
Yes, I am.
Hawkeye. Good afternoon, Pierce. Lieutenant Dish.
Good afternoon, Captain
Hawkeye. Captain Hawkeye Pierce, I had a twix about you. It seems that you stole a Jeep up at headquarters.
No, sir. No, I didn't steal a Jeep. No, it's right outside. Right there.
Oh, so it is.